Welcome to church. So glad you could join us wherever you are, around the world, in your living rooms or your bedroom or on a train, wherever you're watching this. We're so glad you could join us. I guess our prayer today is that you've come seeking the Lord. That's the main thing, isn't it? What church is all about. We could get rid of all of this, all of the music, all the congregation, everything. We could get rid of it. As long as we're gathered, though, in His name to worship Him. That's the point of church. Fellowship with each other and with the Lord. So right now, I ask you to join us as we worship with music. I ask you to open your hearts so that you can seek the Lord. Let's sing, "Open the Eyes of My Heart."
And open the eyes of my heart, Lord. And open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
And open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory, pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see.
I want to see you high and lifted.
Amen. Isn't that the prayer of our hearts, that we want to see the Lord? There's a part of a psalm that I'd like to read as we prepare for this next song. Our focus today is all about the presence of the Lord and desiring God's presence always. And here is some of Psalm 139. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. What a wonderful God we serve. And He is here. So let's be still in His presence.
Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Come bow before Him now with reverence and fear. In Him no sin is found. We stand on holy ground. Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. He burns with holy fire, with splendor He is crowned. How awesome is the sight.
Sense His presence, His glory, His power. I know we're not together, but how wonderful that the presence of God is everywhere and wherever you are today as you watch. So allow me to pray to the living God who is with you and within you. God Almighty, Yahweh, we worship you this day. And we never want to take for granted that you are a God who has chosen to come to us, to come and to make your dwelling amongst us. What an awesome thought beyond our comprehension, that that is how much you love us, that you took on flesh, made your dwelling amongst us, that we could be restored to relationship with you and reconciled to the Father. So I pray for all those watching and for us here that we would sense your nearness, that we would glimpse your glory, and that we would know your power by your Holy Spirit on the inside working and energizing us. Come, Lord Jesus, and bless us as we bless you. Amen. And amen.
Hi everyone, it's great to be here with you today. Welcome to Kids Time. Can you see what I've got here? Yep, it's a fan, a little desk fan from work. Can you see anything coming from it? Let me turn it on first. Oh, can you see anything coming from it? I mean, there's a breeze. I don't see anything. Can you see anything? But I can feel it. How can you know that that's a breeze? Wind is invisible. I know I can feel it, but how can I prove to you, or maybe someone who doesn't believe me, that there's a breeze coming from there? Got something I made earlier. There we go. So this pinwheel helps. Yes, we can see it because the wind is moving the pinwheel around. Just turn this off. The only way you can see the wind outside is because it moves things. Trees, flags, clothes on the line. When they're moving, you know there's a wind. Did you know that the original name for the Holy Spirit was wind? That's right. The old Hebrew word for spirit means wind. We read in the New Testament that when Jesus left earth and the Holy Spirit came, there was a mighty wind. We also know that when you believe in Jesus and accept him as your Saviour, his Holy Spirit lives inside you. I hope you feel God's Holy Spirit close to you, loving you and helping you. One of the hardest things to do is let others see God in us. How can we prove that Jesus is inside us, that the Holy Spirit is moving in us? It's like the problem we had to prove that there was a breeze coming from the fan. We used the pinwheel and showed that there was a breeze. Our actions prove that God's Holy Spirit is in us. He makes us kind, considerate, joyful and patient. And he will also give us many other good qualities. Even though others can't see God, when they see these good qualities, through our kind actions and the way we treat others, they're seeing God's work through us. Thanks for listening. Have a wonderful week. And remember to show everyone how God is working through your life. Bye for now.
In a few moments, we're going to be hearing from the scriptures. And how easy is it to read something and not fully take in the meaning of it? Sometimes we'll read a word and we're like, I don't know what that means, but that's okay. This morning, our focus needs to be to open our eyes to really listening and reading what those words are this morning from the scriptures. And that's our encouragement to you. And this is our prayer for you, is that the Lord will open your eyes and that you will just see Jesus. So will you sing with us and make this your prayer this morning?
Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him, and say that we love him.
Our Bible reading today comes from Matthew number 6, verses 19 to 34 in a New International Version. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, or what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Glory to God.
Greetings. Look, I suspect that as Jesus sat on that hillside speaking what we know today as the Sermon on the Mount, the gathered crowd around him felt like they were hearing things that they may have never heard before, yet things that had a very familiar ring to them. Most of the people that were gathered there would have been born, raised, and educated as Jews, with the rich history of their people taught to them with a sense of pride. Instruction by religious leaders was important and included strict rules about how to live, and perhaps especially how to ensure that they didn't break any of the Ten Commandments. Those commandments had been given by God when he formed them into a nation with himself as their king. So as this teacher, Jesus, spoke, there was much that made sense, sounded sort of new, but perhaps not quite new. Matthew's gospel gives a summary of the people's reaction at the end of this three-chapter sermon. Right at the end of chapter 7, it reads, "When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, for he taught with real authority, quite unlike their teachers of the religious law." The part of the sermon, or Jesus' sermon that we read today, has an echo in the first of the Ten Commandments, namely, "I am the Lord your God who rescued you from the land of Egypt, the place of your slavery. You must not have any other God but me." However, Jesus used a different kind of language and imagery. Instead of repeating, "You must not have any other God but me," he spoke of the desires of the heart. That is where the truth of what is most important to us is hidden. There, the thing that we hold so valuable that it takes priority in the way we choose to order our lives. I was thinking of a particular young man I read about some time ago who had worked really hard to save for his new car. It was the driving force in everything he did, and pardon the pun. He loved that car. He spent a good bit of his time polishing it inside and out, making sure it was well cared for, kept pristine. That car was everything to him. Sadly, this young man was involved in a very minor accident one day, and the car wound up with a small scratch. He was distraught. His beloved car was damaged and he couldn't see it in the same light again. Even if it were to be repaired, it would still be a car that had been damaged. I repeat, that car was everything to him, and it would never be the same again, he decided. He then decided that his life was over. So, sadly, he actually attempted suicide. Now, that may seem like an overreaction to those of us who value the car for what it is, not as some kind of a god that needs to be worshipped with polish and elbow grease. But so clearly there are things in this world that are useful and should be treated with appropriate respect, like a car, for example. But they are things that will not withstand the rigours of normal living. They will rust, wear out, or break, or deteriorate, or get bent out of shape, or stolen, etc., etc. In his own gentle way, Jesus pointed out that these things are not deserving of the priority place in our hearts. But the things of heaven are worthy. They are worthy of that place. In this part of his sermon, Jesus issued invitations to his listeners. And I'm going to suggest there were three invitations concerning the no other God idea. Perhaps the key was Jesus, the main invitation, the key invitation, I think, was where Jesus invited his listeners to enter into a deeply personal relationship with God. He said, "Seek first the kingdom of God." Jesus' hearers were well aware that in their history, the people of Israel were invited to enter into a covenant relationship when God said, "I will be your God and you will be my people." This was a relationship between a king and his people, and the covenant demanded that there be no other God. Or in other words, make the kingdom of God your priority. God is the king. So ordering the way we live life and how we manage our living must, if he is our king, must have God and his ways as our central focus. I wonder, is it realistic to do that in a world where, in a world where every day we're continually challenged with hard choices, with pain, with grief, with sorrow? We've all heard the cry fairly often, I'm sure. Where was God when happened? You can fill in the gap there. The implication, of course, is that if he is the king, shouldn't he use his power and authority to give me an easier life? To stop me from feeling sorrow, to kill the virus, to whatever, again, fill in the gap. These kinds of questions challenge God's love and his ability to care for us. They reflect a heart whose desire is centered in this world's comforts. In the Old Testament, there's the story of a good man named Job who asked these kinds of questions when he was suffering. Of course, he didn't know the full story of why he was suffering, and we really aren't told whether or not he ever did know. But Job was reminded that he, Job, is not God, that God's eternal purposes for allowing things to happen are often beyond our human and limited understanding. There are times, there will be times, when we just simply don't understand and we want to question, even yell at God. And Jesus just gently asks us to, and here's the next invitation, let God be God. Let God do his thing, whatever that might be. He knows our needs. He knows our concerns. He knows our limitations. He knows our circumstance. And Jesus tells us that God cares more for us than he does for the birds of the air that he has made provision for in his creation of the world. In fact, it was pretty much what God told Job. When Job told God he had got things back to front, God pointed out that Job didn't know enough of even the created world nearest around him, let alone the things of eternity and all that is involved there. God made a short list for Job. It was a short list that showed Job was not God. He ended it with, "Is it your wisdom that makes the hawk soar and spread its wings toward the south? Is it at your, excuse me, is it at your command that the eagle rises to the heights that to make its nest?" In a similar way, Jesus reminds us of God's provision. "Isn't life more than food," he said, "and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds. Your heavenly Father feeds them, and you are far more valuable to him. It's the Creator God who made appropriate provision for us to have what we need at any given point in this life." And here's the rub, even if we would rather not be in that particular need at any given point. I wonder if sometimes we, like a stubborn baby being weaned, tend to resist something new from God's hand because we like the way things are, or the way things were before. Trusting our Heavenly Father through the times when life and living seem out of kilter, for whatever reason, is seeking the kingdom of God and letting God do his thing. Only then can we more readily receive his provision from his hand without actually telling God that he might have got it wrong. So Jesus invites us into a personal relationship with God. He invites us to let God be God and not to try to usurp his position. And then Jesus also invites us to live in the moment. Not those words, but let's face it, if we are living in the moment, we're not worrying. Yet worry seems so natural to us. He said, you know, you can't add anything meaningful to your life. We can't add anything meaningful to our lives by worrying. In recent times, I've seen a few memes floating on Facebook that encourage us to live in the present moment. They say the past is over with and can't be changed. The future is out of reach, but the present is ours to live in. On that subject of the present moment, I refer to C.S. Lewis, who was an inspirational writer. His thinking has been a great help to many Christians. He may well be best known for his Narnia Chronicles, but he also wrote a series called The Screwtape Letters. Now, these letters are written as from the devil instructing an apprentice devil in his work. In these letters, the devil refers to God as the enemy and gives insights into the battle for human souls. In one of the letters, he refers to living in the moment. C.S. Lewis has put these words into the devil's writing. I quote, "The humans live in time, but our enemy destines them to eternity. He therefore, I believe, wants them to attend chiefly to two things: to eternity itself and to that point of time which they call the present. For the present is the point at which time touches eternity. Of the present moment, and of it only, humans have an experience analogous to the experience which our enemy has of reality, of whole. In that alone, freedom and actuality are offered to them. End of quote. I'd like to just reiterate some of that in a more positive frame and with slight paraphrase, and just say, the present is the point at which time touches eternity. Of the present moment, and of it only, humans have an experience comparable to the experience God has of reality, of whole. In the present moment alone, freedom and actuality are offered to us. We cannot live in the present moment if we are focused on and worrying about external, material or temporal concerns. The events that have impacted our world and our lives over the last 12 months in particular, with all the instability and uncertainty, could well threaten to rob us of peace and confidence. And in the midst of it, Jesus invites us to get the priorities right, to seek the kingdom of God above all else. The Bible records many times when God's people, Israel, were experiencing some danger and hardships. At one such time, Psalm 46 was written. It begins with the affirmation that God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble, so we will not fear. Then follows the reminder from God, be still. Be still and know that I am God. I will be honoured by every nation. I will be honoured throughout the world. Be still in the present moment and know. Of course, I think it would be remiss of me if I didn't point out that worry is really a form of fear. And we are reminded by the Apostle John in his first letter, chapter 4, that perfect love casts out fear. John also tells us that God is love, perfect love. So to seek for his kingdom in our lives is to invite his love to deal with our fears. Jesus said that putting the kingdom of God first in our hearts, we will find that we are not missing out on all the good things that we think we need from his hand and from this world. Again, to quote C.S. Lewis in a pithy statement, he said, you know, if you aim at heaven, you'll get earth thrown in. If you aim at earth, you will get neither. King Solomon proved this principle as well. When God invited him to ask for whatever he wanted from God with a promise that he would grant the request, Solomon's primary thought wasn't for the same things that the other kings in the world had, like riches, glory, power, etc. He requested that he would have the wisdom needed to govern God's people. This was to be God's kingdom, not Solomon's. And because God's kingdom came first for Solomon, the rest of those things were given to him as well. You might want to check it out in 1 Kings chapter 3. Jesus invites us to be in a healthy relationship with God. Seek the kingdom of God above all else. Let God be God. And know him. He will give you everything you need. I pray that we will each prove this for ourselves. Amen.
Bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart.
Now for a benediction, taken from the letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Philippi in chapter 4. He wrote, "This same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. Now all glory to God our Father, for ever and ever. Amen. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit." We hope you can enjoy, can share with us again next week for our online worship. May God bless you in this coming week. Amen.